Well, in 1979, Masih Alinejad was 2 years old and living in poverty in northern Iran when Ayatollah Khomeini returned from exile and established an Islamic Republic. From a young age, she defied the restrictions imposed on her as a female in that oppressive regime. At 19, she was jailed for anti-government activities. She eventually left Iran. And in 2014, she posted a photo of herself on Facebook with her hair down, telling the world that this simple act would be illegal in Iran. A freedom campaign for the women in Iran fighting against the compulsory wearing of the veil was born. Masih Alinejad has just published her life story called The Wind in My Hair. She now lives in New York and she joined me earlier. Masih Alinejad, thank you so much for giving us your time. You've talked about the daily wars that are fought every day in Iran. What are those daily wars?
As a woman, if you want to actually be a free woman, you have to break the law every day. Like, you know, from the age of seven, when you want to go to school, you're forced to wear hijab. So you have to break the law to be a free girl. As a woman, you are not allowed to sing solo. You're not allowed to dance. You know, you're not allowed to be your true self. You're not even allowed to walk a dog in public. You're not allowed to enter stadiums. You're not allowed to participate in some kind of sports. So that means you have to, you know, get involved in a daily war to be your true self.
Given what you've outlined and the oppression of women, where do other women find the courage to stand up?
You know, I strongly believe that you have only two options in Islamic Republic of Iran, to be victim or to be victorious, to be a warrior, to be a hero in your own life. And there are millions of Iranian women. They learn through their pain how to be powerful and fight back all the boundaries and, you know, the restrictive laws. For 40 years, the Islamic Republic of Iran took our bodies hostage. They wrote their own ideology on our bodies. And for 40 years, women are just, you know, pushing back the boundaries. And this is the only way that you can find a way to be your true self and you carry your own identity. Otherwise, you have to be miserable and stay behind the curtain. But if you see now, there are more than 60% of university are women. So they found how to be powerful, how to be their own storytellers, how to be their own voices, and how to get their bodies and their identities back from the government.
Well, you've paid an enormous price for the stand that you've taken. You've been jailed, you've been cut off from your family, you've been exiled. How have you managed to deal with all of that?
You know, my story is even worse because I grew up in a small village in a poor family. And when you're poor, that means everyone discriminates against you. And I had to fight, for my freedom, even inside my family, inside my house as well. Like, I grew up in a really traditional family. So I had to wear hijab inside the house. And my kitchen even designed for women. Like, my mother was shorter than my father, so the kitchen was designed for just for my mother. So I had to start my own revolution from my own kitchen, from my family's house. And I have to tell you that right now I'm sitting here after publishing my book. I got even attacked by the Iranian state TV. They brought my family in Iranian television to disown me publicly. So when you talk about this, maybe it's just, you know, easy, but it's someone like squeezing, like punching me on my face when I see my family on Iranian state TV. It's like someone is squeezing my heart. But the thing is, this is all happening because Iranian government are scared of powerful women. So on the other hand, I have to say that women in Iran became out of control. My campaign became really huge in Iran and gaining momentum in Iran. And that is why right now the government of Iran scares of women like me.
And you famously said that you have too much hair and you are too much woman for the Iranian regime. And hair has become a real focal point of your protest, particularly the idea of the hijab and rejecting wearing the hijab, the hair cover. Why was hair and the hijab symbolically so important to you?
That's a good question because, you know, I picked up a compulsory hijab issue because this is just the most visible symbol of oppression against women. And there are more, you know, the philosophy behind compulsory hijab is more important than a small piece of cloth itself. Because compulsory hijab is a tool for the government of Iran to control the whole society through women. After the revolution, that was the first step for the government of Iran to put pressure on its own women, to control the whole society, as I said. And when I picked up hijab to fight against compulsory hijab, people were like saying that we have so many bigger problems, which is true. But right now, I'm going to give you an example. Iranian people are suffering from lack of electricity, from lack of water, and they took to the street to fight against the government. But what happened right now? The government of Iran actually sent, bringing a young 70-year-old girl on an Iranian state TV to do a false confession. Why? Because she was dancing. And they sentenced a woman to 20 years prison. Why? Because she removed her hijab. And they brought my family on a state TV. Why? Because I'm fighting against compulsory hijab. So you see, they're using this small piece of cloth to control the whole society rather than focusing on economical problem. They're just oppressing women. And that is why I'm fighting against compulsory hijab, because this is the most visible symbol of a dictatorship, symbol of, you know, Islamic Republic of Iran. Otherwise, there are so many bigger problems in Iran which Iranian government want to distract people to focus on that.
Amissa, do you feel that the West has let you down, that there has not been enough support for the human rights struggle, and that feminists, for instance, have let you down because they have not wanted to appear Islamophobic, so they haven't joined in your struggle?
Let's just start from your, I think Foreign Minister, Julie Bishop, when she was in Iran, you know, she really disappointed not only me, millions of other women who are putting, you know, themselves in danger and risking their lives in fighting against compulsory hijab. So she was there in Iran for the first time. She obeyed compulsory hijab law without even challenging it. And when she was questioned by many other journalists, you know what she said? She said that in the West, we just wear a hat. And in Iran, it was just headscarf. So that just, you know, downplaying our cause. Because she never was beaten up in Australia, in the West, by wearing a hat, like inappropriate hat. But we even being beaten up and being fined, being sent to the court just because of wearing inappropriate hijab. So they actually keep silent, not only for Islamophobia, sometimes for having, you know, commercial or business relation with the Islamic Republic of Iran, and they bury human rights on the, you know, so many other issues. But in America right now, the most problem is that when I fight against compulsory hijab, people are scared to support our cause because they think it makes them Islamophobic, or they want to show their solidarity or sympathy with Muslim minority who's being, you know, attacked here in America. But I have to say that we're not against Islam, but all the Islamic laws are against us in Islamic Republic of Iran. And that is why we invite all, you know, Muslim community to be loud and condemn anything which is happening in the name of Islam in Muslim countries, rather than asking us to keep silent.
So is Donald Trump right then to call out the Iranian regime, to challenge the regime?
Let me be honest with you. Donald Trump challenged the Islamic Republic of Iran. He's absolutely right. But he's there in power to make America great again. So he's there for his own benefits, for his own people. And the travel ban, his policy actually affects my life as well. Because as I said, that he cares about the Americans. But I want my, you know, government to understand right now that the people who are fighting against all the restrictive laws the people who are fighting against the dictatorship, they are in Iran. And so sometimes they use this and saying that because Donald Trump is supporting these people or the West is supporting these people, so they're trying to label Iranian protests. But I have to say that the biggest threat for Iranian regime is right now its own people, not Donald Trump. And for me, I want to say that anyone, Donald Trump or you know, the European Union, the Western government, who sees that the government of Iran oppressing its own people to have deal with the Western country, they have to think about it. My question is this: if one day Iranian government accept Donald Trump conditions and sit down to negotiate with him, what he's going to do? He's going to forget about human rights? This is the issue. What I care, it's human rights. And I don't want human rights to be buried under nuclear deal or any kind of business deal right now.
But was he right, for instance, to tear up the Iranian nuclear deal? Because that is going to put direct pressure on the regime itself with sanctions being reimposed.
I personally want you, I mean, prefer you to ask me about if people in Iran write about, you know, taking to the street and chanting that, where is the benefit of the nuclear deal? Because I myself was a supporter of nuclear deal. And I was, you know, publicly condemning sanction against my own people. But right now what happened, Iranian people took to the streets and they were asking the Islamic regime to stop sending the money to Gaza, to Syria, to Lebanon. And they are actually asking the government of Iran that why the benefit of the deal doesn't, you know, go to our life. So for me, it's important to refer to people inside Iran who are right now actually just today took to the street as well and chanting against the whole, you know, regime. They actually more concerned about whether, let me tell you something. When Donald Trump actually pulled out the deal, Iranian people were not talking about that in public in the street. But when the deal happened, Iranian people took to the street and they were celebrating. So right now, people in Iran, they're disappointed because the benefit didn't go to the people. But again, the sanction is not going to help Iranian people as well. What we want is that we want the Western country and American government to understand that right now they have to, you know, apply the sanction to the Revolutionary Guard, to Iranian state TV, and actually thinking about human rights rather than just thinking about the Iran deal and forgetting about the human rights. And I'm going to give you another example. When the European Parliament, the allegation, the high representative of European Parliament went to my country during the deal, their first condition was that we want to meet the human rights activists. It was before the deal. But after the deal, when they went to my country, they totally ignored human rights. They never wanted to meet with human rights activists. This is the most, you know, concern for Iranian people, that the Western country are going to bury human rights under the nuclear deal.
Can I be clear on what you are actually looking for? Is it just reform of the system in Iran, or is it revolution? Is it regime change, overthrowing the Iranian regime?
You know, I'm a child of revolution in Iran. I don't have any good memory about revolution because the revolution itself became a revolution against women's rights. But I was working for reformist newspapers for years and years. What happened? Nothing has changed. You know, 40 years ago, when we had the revolution and we had the mass execution, people were looking for greater freedom. People were looking for a better, you know, opportunity to live, for better. My parents were poor, so they were looking for a better life. But none of the promises of the revolution has been delivered so far. And right now, people don't have electricity. People don't have water. People don't have, you know, a good opportunity to just personal freedom, basic freedom. And that is why I don't think right now people have any hope on the reformists in Iran. Right now, the main issue in Iran is that how to get rid of the Islamic Republic of Iran. People actually in the streets of Iran, in more than 80 cities, they were asking for Islamic Republic to be gone. They were actually chanting against the dictatorship. They were chanting against the whole clerics. Right now, they're actually saying that in the street. We don't want reformists. We don't want moderate president. We don't want, you know, the conservative. We want a secular democrat country. And all the pressure, actually, all the change is coming within the society. This is the voice of people within the society.
And just finally, personally, if I can go back again to the price that you have paid, I understand that you no longer have contact with your family and you can't return to Iran. What's life like for you right now?
My life is complicated. You know, I'm an immigrant here in America. So my parents are not allowed to leave the country and come and visit me. I am not allowed to go back to my own country. If I go, I have to go to prison, or I don't know what's going to happen to me. When Iranian state TV said that Masih Alinejad was raped in the street of, you know, London because she undressed herself, that was a big lie. When they, you know, lie on Iranian state TV, I don't know what they're going to do with me when I'm there. And here in America, because of travel ban, my life being affected, and I'm not even allowed to leave here in America and go to London and visit my son. So my life is this, and my dream is to go back to my country and you know, hug my family and reunited with my family, because I'm not a criminal, and or have my family here in America, because they are not criminal as well. The government of Iran, the you know, oppressors, they are the criminal, and they have to be banned from, you know, traveling abroad, not my family. And Islamic regime should understand that. They have to listen to the voice of Iranian people rather than just, you know, bringing my family on TV and, you know, asking them to disown me publicly. But let me tell you something. I lost everything. This, you know, situation hurts me. But what gives me the power is just the powerful people inside Iran, the powerful women inside Iran. One day when they arrested one of the women of my campaign, my White Wednesdays campaign, this woman actually went in front of the court. She took off her hijab and she said that by arresting me, by threatening me, you cannot keep me silent. And that actually gives me the hope that these people are going to bring the change within the society.
Masih Alinejad, thank you again for giving us your time.
Thank you so much for having me.